Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to the bottom of the barrel. Alright. Before I get started on talking about everything about wrestling, I'd like to explain why I've been kind of absentee over the last little while. My day job had me doing video support for quite a while. That's now stopped. But, you know, I thought doing video all the time is like, I like being in front of this camera. I like the stuff that I do. I really started to hate it talking to people. I mean, you know, you spend 8 hours a day talking at a camera and having to deal with people's first world problems. It starts to drive you a little bit batty. And so you don't really want to come home and do videos again. So I apologize for not taking as much time as I used to with my videos. I think I've said this about 5 times now. One of these days I'm going to get it right and I'll start getting this all back together again. But this is a rather big time for the WWE. The greatest champion of all time, Vacant, has once again claimed the WWE Championship. And there's a tournament underway to determine which man will take it from him. Because Vacant never wrestles matches, he just gets awarded titles and then hands them back over. So, I was thinking about the tournament, and while there have been some great matches coming out of this, I mean, my God, you know, so Cesaro versus Roman Reigns last night was a really good matchup. There was a lot that I feel is wrong going into this tournament. And it has a lot to do with the fact that, really honestly, I hate to do the back in my day kind of thing, but there was a point where wrestlers just seemed like they were more manly, maybe had more stamina, had more to them than they do nowadays. I mean, granted, today's WWE superstars and independent wrestlers and stuff do some maneuvers that are amazing. Things that we never would have thought of back in the day. Things that wrestlers didn't even aspire to begin with. The stuff that Neville does is absolutely amazing, for instance. And yet for all of this, you know, 2 matches in one night just seems like too much to them. You don't see these men do 1 hour Broadways, night in and night out, wrestling until they're burnt to the bone. And maybe that's good, that's going to keep their lifespan longer. But at the same time, I think it was about 2008 was the last time we had a tournament where all in one night, a wrestler had to go through 3 matches to win. And that was when William Regal became King of the Ring. We were in the all in one night on Raw, and he managed to beat CM Punk in the finals. This really shows an opportunity that's lost with these wrestlers. And I say this because the quarterfinal matches that took place last night should have been on the Survivor Series. These men, this is the WWE Championship. These men should be out there wrestling and going at it and being burnt to the very crisp to prove that they are the man, that they are the guy who deserves to carry around that gaudy piece of leather and diamonds that they're now currently calling the WWE Championship. However, despite the weirdness of the WWE title, if they want this championship to have value, they obviously do. They combined both world titles. They've really made a statement to make this championship something special. I mean, you know, Seth Rollins had a pretty decent reign. Wasn't spectacular, but it was a decent reign before he got injured and had to lose the championship belt. The fact is, these guys should be giving us those 3 matches in one night. And we're going into Survivor Series, one of the original 4 major pay-per-views. The second oldest pay-per-view next to WrestleMania itself. And it's got 6 matches scheduled. 2 semifinals, 1 finals. The Brothers of Destruction versus 2 members of the Wyatt family. The Divas Championship match. And now they've just added, finally, a Survivor Series matchup that has no fucking participants in it. Can you believe this? This was announced on WWE.com. It was like, we don't know who any of the participants are, but we're going to have a traditional 5-on-5 Survivor Series matchup. Yay. I remember when Survivor Series matchups actually had a purpose. You had a team captains who actually hated each other and wrestlers who had feuds with each other, and it made sense. It worked. This, we don't know who it's going to be, but it's going to happen, is retarded. And I know that they've had to rush, especially considering, excuse me, my nose is itching, that the WWE Championship being vacant and they're having to get through the tournament and prepare it. But going back to what I said, is those quarterfinals really should have taken place at the Survivor Series. It would have packed up this pay-per-view, it would have made it full, and it really would have shown that these wrestlers deserve that championship. Bret Hart in 93 went through three solid matches to become King of the Ring. You had Steve Austin also in the King of the Ring tournament go to the hospital, get his lips stitched up, and still become King of the Ring. You had The Rock go through three matches at the 1998 Survivor Series to become the WWF champion. Time after time after time, it's testing the mettle of superstars. And whether or not, you know, cases of The Rock where he got a quick pinfall victory over top the Big Boss Man and then also had the cheat win for him when he joined the corporation, it still was story. It was still was there. But there's no point in dwelling on what was. I've done that for 6 minutes. Let's dwell on the fact that, let's take a look at what we got. And right now we have a very predictable outcome. And we have a very predictable setup. Because when I viewed over this matchup and this tournament, this was the semifinals I expected to see. I expected Owens versus Ambrose. I expected Alberto Del Rio versus Roman Reigns. Yeah, and honestly, this tournament has been rather devoid of surprises. And before you start commenting on Kalisto beat Ryback, that was a big surprise, shut up. Because that, while surprising, was the exact way the WWE got you that excuse of, we gave you anything can happen in this tournament, Kalisto beat Ryback, only to get beaten by Alberto Del Rio. Speaking of last night's quarterfinal match between Alberto Del Rio and Kalisto, does the man formerly known as Dos Caras Jr. have a serious problem with Kalisto? Because he yanked off the kid's mask, albeit I think by accident, because he did help him put his mask back on and whatnot. Two, he hard clotheslined him, and I'm like just like straight forearmed him practically across the nose in a clothesline. And then his rather sloppy double boot off of the middle rope that just like looked sideways and landed badly, and Kalisto landed badly. I mean, seriously, why the fuck was he roughing up this poor kid? Does he have some sort of family grudge against him? I know in Mexico they take the wrestling very, very seriously there. If anybody knows a history between these two, please tell me, because by God, Alberto Del Rio just took some real fucking liberties with Kalisto last night. And I was very, very disappointed in the man from San Luis Potosi, Mexico, and how he handled himself, because that was bad. That was actually one of the worst matches of the night, just on the pure brutality and the way it was handled, and it was sloppy. And it clearly was all on Del Rio. It was not Kalisto's fault. We also, last night, I have to give the upsides to this tournament. This tournament has produced some quality matchups. We have got, Tyler Breeze going against Dean Ambrose was a great match. I really enjoyed Roman Reigns versus Cesaro last night. It was enough that my wife actually turned away from the computer and started paying attention. The match was really good. The outcome was predictable, but the match was good. The tournament has provided us with some enjoyable matches. Kalisto and Ryback was a very good matchup on SmackDown. There have been decent matches coming out of this tournament, so it's been interesting to see how it develops and where it goes. On the other hand, I just know that there's only one reasonable outcome, and that is that we're probably going to get a finals between Ambrose and Roman Reigns. Now, don't get me wrong, that's not bad. These two men are the best of friends, and obviously there's got to be room for one of them to turn heel. But I think when they did this tournament, and they set up last week on Raw, they really lost an opportunity to do something very, very interesting. Roman Reigns should have accepted Triple H's offer. and then gotten screwed by Triple H at Survivor Series. Because what Triple H was really looking for was not only the man who would do anything, but the man who would step up and do it as well. So that Triple H would take the winner of the tournament, the man who faces Roman Reigns, and place him higher. And I think that would have been a great place for Ambrose, or a great place for Cesaro. But it's opportunity lost. And right now we have a very high possibility of Roman Reigns becoming WWE champion anyway. Is that bad? No. Is it predictable? Yes. And I wish I could say I was more excited than I am. And right now, the only way the WWE is going to surprise anyone is if anybody besides Roman Reigns wins the title. I think I said Roman Reigns earlier. If I said Ambrose, I meant Roman Reigns is going to walk out WWE champion. I did say Roman Reigns? Okay, I thought I said Ambrose for a second there. Either way, I meant Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns is most likely to come out of this whole thing as WWE champion. However, right now the whole story is anyone but, you know, Roman Reigns for Triple H. So it's going to be one of two things. Either Roman Reigns is going to climb that mountain and get past it, or Triple H is definitely going to screw him out of it in the end. And who better to screw him out of it? Not Ambrose, although I think him and Ambrose having a feud would be good. Kevin Owens. I think if they wanted to do it right, Kevin Owens should become Triple H's man for a while and become the Intercontinental and WWE champion. That's just my opinion on the way I think it should go or could go. I think it would also be interesting if Ambrose did somehow pick up the victory and then Roman Reigns snaps and beats the holy hell out of Ambrose after the matchup. Again, another interesting way of going about it. Although right now they're going, we're friends and it's all right. And they did a whole thing after Raw, apparently, that, you know, we're friends, but winner take all at Survivor Series. Ha 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 ha. Camaraderie. And, you know, I guess if we got the handshake at the end and everyone was happy with the champion, then they could do that too. I'm also finding that I feel that there's another missed opportunity here. While it's all great that Undertaker and Kane are going to go up against two members of the Wyatt family, is it that hard to find two partners for Undertaker and Kane and do a Survivor Series match between Team Dead Man or Team Brothers of Destruction versus the Wyatt family? However you want to call it. Is it that hard? Finn Balor fits the bill right off the bat to fit in. I know Sting's injured, but I'm sure you could find somebody to fill that role for the fourth man. The fact is, this match doesn't have that Survivor Series feel. And it gives me that feel of, once again, Bray Wyatt's going to start the fight, and the other guy's going to finish it. And while I love The Undertaker, there's a certain amount of irony in the literal not passing of the torch in this particular one. If Bray is supposed to be that carry-on for Undertaker, it's time. Let's move forward. But I could be wrong. And we have 6 matches on the card now. I'm sure by the end of SmackDown or the SmackDown taping today that they probably managed to squeeze in a tag team title matchup if the tag team champions aren't going to be involved in that Survivor Series match they talked about. I'm sure more will be revealed on that one. There's got to be something more, because unless they're going to really put a lot of time and effort into these 6 matches, I don't know. And I'll be back a little later this week to give my full predictions for the Survivor Series event once the card is finalized. So tell me what you've thought about the tournament. Do you like it? Do you think it's bad? Where do you think the WWE is going? Do you think that they're going to just go down the safe and predictable route as they appear to be doing? Or do you think they'll try something different? Feel free to comment below. And as always, if you aren't already, please like, share, and subscribe. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this barrel's been scraped clean. I know I kind of went in a circle on this one, but God, this has just been annoying the fuck out of me about this tournament. I hope it turns out to be better than I think.